Hello, Narnach here. Welcome back to Path of Exile. We're gonna run another tier 6 map today, and it's gonna be the Colonnade. We have modifiers in here that make it inhabited by skeletons that shoot additional projectiles. I'm expecting a lot of archers and mages here. If it's gonna be frost mages, that's gonna be fun. I've got some experience with frost mages freezing me when they hit or crit too much. They also gain endurance charges every 20 seconds and they take less damage from our crits. Good thing is we're not critting for the damage, we're critting, well, just for freezing everything. And the freezing is gonna be in effect nonetheless, but the reduction in crit damage does mean that we're gonna crit for less damage, and as a result the freeze is gonna stick slightly shorter. So let's see. So Colonnade is based on the Battlefronts map, and apparently the layout is pretty easy, pretty straightforward. Just getting my bearings a little bit. See if this is similar to another map. The name currently escapes me, but there is another map that has a similar tile set, where it's just one big line. It's basically the ledge, but in a similar tile set to this. So good thing is frozen monsters don't shoot back. And I was expecting, there are archers here. So does this extend in all directions? As in, do we have backtracking, or is this like a big square? Because then you also have a relatively straightforward map. So apparently the boss here is based off of coal. The slightly more angry cousin or brother or something of the warden. So that's gonna be an interesting fight. If he manages to grab us when we don't expect it, then it's gonna be fun. I mean, normally in the Lunaris Temple, you know exactly what you're getting into, at least if you've played it a couple times. As a first-time player, that's gonna be an interesting surprise, so to say. But luckily, we don't have that. We don't have that here. So you stop trying to murder me. Thank you very much. Right. He even had the goal to die before I was finished with saying whatever I was saying. Okay, so this seems to be the width of the area. So it's relatively ledge-like in that regard. It's just a white ledge, but with a pretty cool layout. Hello, frost mages. Oh, thunder guards. So those are lightning mages. If they crit, they hurt. And they shock, that's even worse. Spark mages. So we'll just keep zigging and zagging. Just to get a relatively full clearing. Okay. And then, yeah, we're roughly picking up where we left off. So, maps that are rather straightforward like this are, well, they're nice and easy to run. You never have the idea that you're always backtracking, or well, you never feel like you're wasting a lot of time. That's probably the best way to put it. Maps with layouts where you end up having to go, no, if you have to cross parts of the map more than 2 or 3 times, then you usually end up feeling rather unhappy. Ooh, an exalted orb. Those are rather infrequent finds. I've still actually yet to do something with the previous find. But oh, usually once you start shopping for things that cost an exalted orb, you are gonna have to bring more than one. At least in standard league. That's there's just so many exalted orbs. There's just so much currency in general in this league that things are either just trivially cheap. Yes, that's what I was trying to say. Either they're just really cheap, or they are rather expensive, and then they're expensive to the tune of multiple exalts. So, on the other hand, there is of course always the option of just YOLO exalting, also known as actually using the bloody thing. But technically, most of the time, using those things, it's economically unwise. Also, I'm noping out of here. They're hurting me way much, then. Way more than I was planning to get hurt. Because this build doesn't really have any built-in regen. With the exception, of course, of hitting the flask. But still, it's only 4% of our maximum energy shield that we get regenerated per second then. Which means it takes a full 25 seconds to recharge back to full. And it only lasts for 5.8 seconds. So, yeah, we're not gonna make it full. Okay, so it seems like we are turning a corner here, so let's backtrack a little bit. Also, maybe I should curse you guys. Just running around with the dual cursor, not having to think about curses, and switching back to a character that has manual cursing. You definitely appreciate the dual cursing blasphemy build way, way more. Let's just backtrack and then do the corner over there. Let's see, have an orb, have some curses, and then we just blow you to bits. Just cast slightly closer to increase the width of the angle so we just hit more of them. And then we focus on the boss. Maybe we should curse you a little bit. Yeah. Boom. And here, your own personal frostbolt. Aren't I generous? You can even have two, if that's what you need. And indeed, we just found the edge here. So I experimented a little bit with shifting my links around a little bit. Wow, we're doing over 15,000 damage with all five of our frenzy charges up. It's usually just 10,000 if they are not. Let's go back up. Yeah, kill you guys, get our keep our charges up. Yes, excellent. Now I experimented a little bit with just shifting things around, see if there were some room for improvement, things like that. Putting greater multiple projectiles in the main link instead of cold penetration is interesting experiment. You lose your resistance penetration, even though you still have your frostbite to fall back on, of course. So that's what are we up to by now? We're at 35% resistance penetration, which now in the worst case it's just 35% more damage. In the best case it's quite a bit more. It can be as much as 100%. It just depends on how much resistance the target has. But if you take it out and instead add a greater multiple projectiles, suddenly you are shooting a lot of projectiles all over the place, and you hit about 7,500 to 8,000 damage, excluding the frenzy charges, of course. Frenzy charges, they add about 50% on top, so you would hit about 10k. Again, you will miss out on the resistance penetration, but you do get a lot more projectiles. Because I was thinking, for this build, currently we have one skill occupying two slots. So we have our single target frostbolt, which, well, it does respectable damage. It actually hits almost 17,500 damage there. Once again, excluding resistances. So the effective DPS with this, it could go much, much higher. It could easily be double that. Well, what if you dropped the group frostbolt in favor of maybe having vortex or frostbomb in its own link rather than a combined tree link, and using it to apply maybe a cast on crit frostbolt, frostbite, I mean. Now, if you do a vortex, cast on crit vortex with increased AoE, then you have a relatively low damage, high area of effect skill that, well, because I'm focusing on crits, I'm likely to just make it crit anyway. Now the 40% crit rate, I might not get it, but I might get 25% crit rate. So if you get a cast on crit, or curse on hit, that might even be better. I don't even need to cast on crit, I can just do a curse on hit. So you hit him, you slow him, you curse him. And all you have to do is every once in a while just exchange one of these into an AoE, and it will just curse all your opponents. Seems like an interesting way to play. It would definitely put a Vortex back on the map, because currently Vortex, it's there. Oh, the build is a Frostbolt Vortex character, so it's there for, I feel compelled to keep it in because it's in the name. The skills got introduced together, and Superior Anger. That's just one step above having a bad hair day, isn't it? Superior Anger. But yeah, currently it feels like Vortex is there, but it's a bit of an underused skill. And having to manually cast the Frostbite every once in a while feels clunky if you're used to just automatically applying your curses. And we just don't have the mana reservation capacity left in order to go dual curse. That's the other thing. I don't want to give up my discipline because it helps me determine most of my health pool. Well, not most, but it's a pretty significant part, so you don't want to go without discipline here. But repurposing Vortex as a damage application skill. Hello there, Armios Bill. Here. Just because you are being so twitchy, I'll just give you a lot of targets to aim at. Bye bye. So yeah, that's something I just before I started recording, I thought of it. So I just shuffled things around a little bit and just looked at the numbers. I haven't actually done a lot of gameplay playing with it. Yes, I kept getting interrupted while casting. Seriously? Wow, that rarely happens. Oh, Frost Harbingers. They're cool. No pun intended. So I think I might... Ah! Boss. Oh yeah, wait. Did I just reuse up my army of the damned there? Yes, I think I did. Okay, you are frozen. I'll just put some of the minion there. Yeah. Yeah. He is the kind of guy you don't want to piss off. Really. Okay, minions. I'm just gonna save up for an army. I'm just gonna kill a lot of minions and save up for an army. Because he hurts, this is gonna be an interesting yet technical fight. So we're just gonna cheat, we're just gonna summon the army. Well, if there's enough minions of his available, to be honest. Did I kill them all? No. Okay, so that right there is the main reason why you shouldn't use things like Vaal skills frivolously. And exiles definitely don't count as a valid reason for using Vaal skills. Okay. There's the guy. Yeah, you're standing way too close, buddy. You're standing way too close. Okay. You. Did you actually stun me? Yes, you did. Okay, so. Good, good. We just clear this a little bit. And then army o'clock. And we curse you and then we shoot you from a distance. Wait. I'm standing in the corner and they're spark maging me. That's well played. Well played! Ow! And I was trying to flame dash out, but I kept getting interrupted. This. Wow. Most of the time, spark mages really aren't that interesting, actually, as an enemy. But here, they definitely hurt. Note to self, don't stand in the corner. Spark mages hurt. Okay. Luckily, we don't have to walk too far. Oh, also, it might be useful to reapply things. So, 46-70 health. And it becomes nearly 6,000. So it's 1,500. That's one quarter of our total health. That is part of That's just as a direct effect of the discipline. While we're on our way, might as well just clear some enemies so they don't follow us. Pick up a nice rock breaker here. And now we are getting where we were. Allies move and attack faster, definitely something you wanna take out. Oh, see, he was nearly dead. Just I died faster. Yeah, CI is definitely a build I... If you're going an energy shield build on hardcore, CI is a way to deal with the chaos damage, but the trade-off of not having access to instant heal flasks, that's tricky. Nope. Personally, I don't like using lockout macros. I never actually have used one. Not as a judgmental thing, but my personal take on it is that they feel like cheating. If other people want to use them, fine, but personally, I would feel like I'm cheating, so that's why I don't use them. The trade-off is that I will lose characters in situations where other people with quick reflexes and a lockout macro would make it out. And a situation like this, if you're getting stunned and there's nothing you can do and you're trying to dash out, maybe if you hit a lockout macro, that would help you. You save your character. But yeah, I'm actually very happy the way just Path of Exile works, that if you lose your hardcore character, you just get demoted to Standard League and you can continue playing in Standard League. Oh, if you enjoy a character, then you can just continue playing it as is. And that is fine. Especially if you lose your character for a rather arbitrary reason. Lag spikes, bosses that are unbalanced, broken mechanics that are new to the game and still have to be properly tweaked, things like that. But yeah, so let's see. So what I was gonna say, if we to have the old added gold, that contributes quite some damage. Just a little bit of theory crafting. So we're currently at rest, we are 10,000 damage. If we take the added gold off, it's 9. So that's only 10% of our damage. Technically, that's not quite a lot. But if you put greater multiple projectiles in, then of course it drops. It goes to 6.5. Interestingly, the single target, it actually rises because greater multiple projectiles, it's a less damage modifier. So we take flat damage off, we add multiple projectiles. Now our main attack is this one. It penetrates cold resistance, it has ice bites, so it has an increased chance of freezing, and we have increased criticals. So we have a pretty decent skill. Let's see, that's the one with all the letters. So that's nearly 42% chance to freeze them. We do pretty decent damage per hit, and we hit shoot 1.5 times per second. And if you look at the mana, it's relatively stable. We of course, as a trickster, we have a couple of tricks up our sleeves, and Weave the Arcane is very nice for managing your mana, and you can really push yourself quite a bit further than you normally would. And I might even consider just double checking all the notes I have. I think I might already have just took all the extra mana regen things out. So I used to have this one, I used to have these. This one might be a point you could salvage. Well, anyway, it's just really good for mana management. So if you have this as your main attack, it's just a standard group attack. If you get frenzy charges, damage is gonna go up to 10, maybe 11,000. So it's a bit lower than what we currently have, but it's easier to hit bosses. And no, especially if you have the more mobile bosses, like for example, Carnage, the boss we just fight. I was shooting way more with the AoE Frostbolt, which, just for reference, used to be at 5,500 DPS rather than 6,500 DPS. So if we have this as our standard attack, then we have multiple projectiles that we can actually turn into a vortex. Let me just take this frostbolt out. Boom. Gone. So we have frostbomb, which has an increased AoE, and then if we take the vortex, we move it over here. Let's have a look if we have all the gems. We can just double check, do we have anything with quality on it? It's always nice. No, there's no, oh, hardly any blue supports with quality. And nothing here. Okay, so now we just go back to the normal ones. So we have increased AoE. Increased area, level 1. I do have a couple, I remember kicking out some. So this is a 16, that seems fine. So we're gonna, yeah, we'll give that to the crystal wand, to the frost pump. Keep vortex with increased AoE. Okay, then we have, of course, we have a curse, don't we? Enfeeble, blasphemy, discipline, frostbite, increased AoE. Oh, of course, we already had one. So we put this one back, we salvage this. Just put it back. So we have a vortex. We're gonna link that with increased AoE, frostbite, and we need a curse on hit. Curse on hit, curse on hit. Do we have a higher level curse on hit? Yes, level 5. Okay. That's all. You don't really need too high a level. So this is gonna be 4 times blue. We have blue and green in mixes. What are we gonna do with frostbomb? So we got frostbomb but increased AoE. And some people add a less duration to it, so it triggers faster and you get more damage out of it. But personally, I use frostbomb as a curse. I use it for the negative 20% to cold resistance. So the increased AoE just means it affects more monsters. And the explosion, I don't really care about. On the other hand, if it's gonna explode, if we give it increased critical chance, because it's a 6%, it has a better chance of critting than other things would. It's a nearly 48% chance to crit, on top of the built-in 20% chance to freeze that it already has. So it's gonna suppress cold resistance, and after that it's just gonna hit hard. And it has a pretty good chance of freezing. Without this, it would be at 32%. So this really does increase the crit chance relatively by 50%. 32 to 48, that's really just 16% on top, so that's good. So we get Vortex. We want this one to be pure blue. So let's go over here. Add it to here, and then we are just gonna see if we get lucky. That's what I call luck. Well, it's a good thing. It's a dex and int, so you get a pretty decent chance of just rolling pure blues on this. Also, I realize I should probably run Merciless Labyrinth once or twice to see if we can get something better on here, because I'm not using punishment. Well, that's just an aside. Okay, so the good thing is, why I was actually doing this is because I want to use both of my Vaal skills. So we have Frostbolt. We revive Vortex to our right mouse button. And then we even have this one available. Because there's nothing really on here, is there? I'll just start, keep our auras visible. And then for now, we have 2 slots available down here that we can assign to anything. We could do something like Valska skeletons, and we'll just assign something nice and blue to them. Increase kit, whatever. We'll just give you increase kit, and then we put all the other gems in here. Ah, I still had some gems in here. Is that a curse on hit? That's a level 7 curse on hit. It's better than a level 5. Chaos Golem, Vengeance. Increased crit damage. Yep, that's also not quite bad. Okay, so let's run around with this for a little bit. We already did Colonnade, so of course we're gonna return to everybody's favorite. We're gonna do a very quick run of the Dried Lake. Just to see. So, main attack, AoE. And we can just explode them. And of course, we have a very low level thing. So, this is just gonna be the standard thing. We kill stuff. Every bunch of kills. And indeed, it also curses. So, the interesting thing is that if monsters are strong enough, you don't really care. Are you a Storm Herald? You are. Stop doing that. So, if they're surrounding you, you can just simply cast this. And you do affect them. And the damage over time is pretty decent. They are slightly too far away, but then of course, Frostbolt plus Vortex means ranged Vortex. So, we'll just keep upping the crits. And that's just of the Army of the Damned, which not. We'll throw it at full. No, we're not gonna use it before the time is right. This being a 67 area means no, the monsters aren't terribly, terribly strong. We are used to dealing with stronger enemies by now. So of course we are going to be overpowered, but that's secretly that's the purpose of running Dried Lake. Because then anything you come up with just seems super powerful. It's just demo mode, just cheating at doing a demo. But it's also the easiest thing. It's consistent, it's a very good frame of reference. The reverse is also true. If you can't run Dried Lake with a build, then no, you don't even have to try maps. And if you're just blazing through, chances are Dried Lake's gonna work. Okay, we were shooting down here and then we heard something. So indeed, there's a Judas Orb here. Regular mobs die slightly faster now because our common attack is a 5 link rather than a 4 link now, so it does more damage. So that's an upside. That's definitely an upside. Because before we were using the right mouse button, Vortex, and as a result we dealt less damage, we didn't have elemental resistance, piercing. So all in all, we definitely gained from this. Okay, we are through the pillars, so the dude should be somewhere here by now. The dude, of course, being the Emperor Vaal. So I'm slowly also starting to understand the added value of, what was it called? There's this bit here, practical application. You have a chance to avoid getting a stunt while casting. If your life is at 1, basically any strong hit is gonna stun you. So 25% chance to dodge, 55%. I believe there's another 15 here that gets you to 70%. So well, if you want, you definitely can try to not get stunned. Oftentimes, just common mobs, just shooting frost balls at them until they fall over is easier than invoking the Vortex. On the other hand, no, Vortex is pretty decent. If you're just skirting by, you just explode them and they'll just die over time. Okay, well, frost balls with Vortex, This way, it does feel slightly more active as a build. Might be because I'm just strictly focusing on it, and the next time I sit down to play, I focus more on Frostbolt. That's always the case. There's always differences in nuance to how you play a build. If no, you don't strictly need to play it in one way or the other. But with this design, you inflict the curses and the damage at the same time, and you have a stronger control element because you're more proactive about placing vortices all around and therefore slowing enemies. Also, I had expected to find Vaal by now, because usually he's either here or he's there, and now he is neither. What is going on? We just bumped into a wall. Of course, it's here. And of course, hitting things and cursing them pretty nice, since you have less steps to take, and if there's less steps to take, then there's less things to go wrong or to forget in the thick of battle. Especially boss battles where you're moving around a lot. It's very easy to forget the cursing bit, or the vortex bit, or whatever, or a frost bomb. Now you can just shoot things. So, frost bomb, we shoot. Especially because we're shooting 5 projectiles now, it's so much easier to hit the guy. And now the hits are less powerful, but if you hit him more often, in the end, it will balance out in terms of effective damage that you do. And as you saw, we did defeat him rather easily. So, yeah, I think we're gonna keep it like this. I'll have to find a good purpose for the empty slots. We'll just shuffle that around a little bit. And then next episode, you'll see the results. So, gonna thank you very much for watching. I'll see you again next time. Bye-bye.